Well, we are returning from foot patrol and about maybe 100 meters from the entrance of the base. We meet up with a motorcycle, a guy in a motorcycle. I search him, shake his hand, and as I move away, as I'm about to step in the highway, boom, everything goes up in the air. I get tossed up in the air. I land on my back, and at that moment I'm thinking, oh my God, and my legs are still there. So I look down and I see, okay, my legs are still there. I'm still able to fight. I roll to my side and I see that several soldiers are down on the ground. You know, this talking about my RTO, my radio operator. So immediately I get up and I can feel, you know, shortness of breath. I feel like as if a baseball bat just hit me in the back of the leg. So I immediately, I kind of hop up to the soldiers that were by the wall and I ask them, hey, change my radio. I need to get in touch with somebody. And they just didn't know how. So I send them all the way up to get help, while on the radio I could hear people asking for help and people yelling for help down the hill. So I turn around, I look at my leg and I'm bleeding, and I'm thinking, well, I either help the people down there or I can spend time here putting the tourniquet on my own leg. And I figure, you know what, as long as I can still fight, I can still help them out, and I'll take care of them first. I run down the hill and I get to Specialist Curtis. And when I get to Curtis, I talk to him. Hey buddy, you all right? Are you all right? And he kind of moans back to me, which later I came to find out it was him kind of giving his last breath. So, you know, immediately I start putting tourniquets on his legs, you know, and make sure he wasn't bleeding. And, you know, all of a sudden, doc comes to me and I tell him, hey doc, can you finish this? Can you finish this? I gotta take care of the other people. And he says, okay, that's fine, I got it. So I run down the hill. I pass by my squad leader. I got a private and a team leader working on my squad leader. And you know, I grab a skid coat off the back of my private and I run down the hill, because I remember thinking that there was a pressure plate ID where my radio operator was at, you know, where his body was at. So, and he was laying down there, and at that moment I have a couple of soldiers going toward him to help him out. So I grabbed the skid coat, I run down the hill even further. That's when I got to PFC Miari, and you know, the soldier just turns up to me, you know, Specialist Thorne just turns up to me and says, man, he's dead, he's gone. So I unroll the skid coat, I try to put his body in it, because I'm thinking, there's a secondary ID in here, let's get out of the kill zone before something explodes again. I mean, we try to work with him there and we couldn't make it. So I tell him to go back to cover, you know, and obviously at that point in time, we've been taking in fire. So we're running around, I mean, I'm getting down the ground. At that point in time, I remember, you know, hearing the big, you know, big mosquitoes passing by your head, zoom, zoom, you know, the rounds. So I kind of dive down a little bit, come back up to my knee, and I see a couple guys rooftops. So I take a couple shots, bop, 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 bop. You know, and my guys are returning fire. I mean, it's just pure chaos. From there, I mean, obviously, at this point in time, we're taking fire, so everybody's just getting up, getting down, you know, and trying to get behind cover, you know, shooting back, that kind of stuff. Everybody's just running around. I was just really hurt and I couldn't breathe, and it was just hard running up and down that hill. So that's when the idea of the gator came in mind. Hey, let's grab the gator. So I ran uphill, I jump on the gator, I put my weapon in there. You know, I tell the guy that's taking cover behind the gator, you know, Sergeant Drake, I tell him, hey man, I'm sorry, I'm taking your cover, but you know, I got you. I'll get you back to cover before I take it away from you. So I grind the gears, you know, put it in drive, and I drive it up enough so he can take cover behind it, and he goes back inside the base, you know, takes cover behind a Hesco wall, and I make a wide turn. You know, I'm thinking, I gotta drive this down the hill as straight as possible. I can't roll this over, you know, just make another casualty right there, you know, if I roll over on top of the people that are down the hill. So I meet that hill 90 degree angle. I go down straight. As I go down straight, I can feel that I'm losing control of the gator. You know, we're scared. I remember my squad leader looking at me, and I mean, he was out of it. He didn't know what was going on. And I remember telling him, "Sergeant, don't worry, Sergeant, I got you. I got you. Team leader's taking care of it for you." So I'm saying, "God, please let back be reversed." You know, and I grind the gear back. I pull back up, pull close to the casualty, to my squad leader. And everybody, you know, we're gonna start loading them up. So I grab the rifle again, start providing cover. At the time, Private Mancini kind of takes a knee next to the gator too. We're both returning fire. We're talking to each other, directing, "Hey, get as much SI as we can. Let's put it back in the back of the gator." So we start putting them up. I mean, just getting them out of there was crazy, you know. So as I was going up, I'm thinking, you know, how are we gonna get these guys up here? I mean, the hill is pretty steep, you know. I don't think this got enough power, but you know, we'll see. So I grind the gear forward again, and I'm driving, and I'm thinking, all right, I gotta meet this as 90 degree angle as possible, straight as possible, so I can get full power out of the wheels. So I take a wide turn. As I take that wide turn, I go up the hill, and I mean, it's taking it, and I'm praying, you know, and you just hear the rounds buzzing by, and you know, and We're getting up the hill, the power's not going, and I'm thinking, "Please, Lord, let this go through, you know." And right there, just at that moment, that's when we make it, you know, make it right through in the top of the hill. And as I drive back inside the base, and I see people, and I can see their eyes. And their eyes looking at me like, "What's going on? Oh my God, we didn't even know you're outside the wire." So I pass by, I tell people, hop in the gear, let's help out. So, you know, one of my one of the squad leaders jumps inside of the gator with me, and I start driving up the hill. That's when I see the medics, you know, and then all of a sudden all the medics start jumping on top of the gator too, start helping, you know, the guys behind it. You know, that's when I just drive straight back, and you know, I can tell that everything is going, you know. I mean, I can barely take a breath. My leg's going numb. I can barely press the gas, you know, but I mean, we did what we could do. I remember going up and down that hill several times and just, you know, doing everything I could. And obviously, the boys performed beautifully. I mean, all of them were fighting as a single unit, everybody providing cover. And if it wasn't for them, I guarantee you, I'd have been shot that day. And if it wasn't for their dedication, I mean, none of them. I mean, I remember being there and we're talking, and you know, no men left behind. When the adrenaline kicks in, you know, you don't really think about it. You just kind of, I mean, you know you're hurt, you understand, but, you know, I mean, I think it's a matter of choice. You know, you choose to fight back, and once you make that choice, you just go. You know, you don't let anything stop you. And, I mean, I had been hit by a grenade, you know, a couple weeks earlier, you know, maybe a month earlier, so it wasn't, for me, it didn't feel like that big a deal. You know, I mean, I understood I was hurt, and you know, but you just keep pushing and keep doing what you got to do. And obviously, you know, afterwards when I was getting help, I mean, that's when I felt the full effects of, you know, of the injuries. And you know, I probably couldn't walk for two weeks to a month later. You know, but I worked as hard as I could to get back in patrol right away. You know, to make sure that everybody knew that I was ready to fight right away. But you know, it's something that you really don't think, you can't really think of. You know you're hurt, but if you stop to feel sorry for yourself, or you stop to, you know, obviously if the injuries are to an extent that you need to take care of them, of course you will. You know, you will help yourself and make sure you're ready to fight. But I think the intent right there, the underlying intent, is you always got to be ready to fight, because you always fight first. And as long as I could fight, I was going to fight.
guy turned his bike on, prayer was done, took a couple steps, started walking away, and the guy blew himself up as we picked up and started moving. That's how that started. After the blast, I got up, we heard calling for help, and I was engulfed in the clouds. I couldn't see anyone around me. I mean, there was a guy that was a couple feet from me, and I was attached to us. I couldn't even see him, but I heard calling for help, and I started to push through, and I called on the radio that we needed help. And by the time I got through to get the casualties, prayer was coming down the hill, and going to the first casualties and starting to work on them. I saw that he was hurt. He was kind of was favoring his one leg. He just immediately started jumping on the casualties, getting them, putting tourniquets on, and everything we were trained to do. But it felt good to have someone I trusted there to know that, hey, he can, I could let him work on, do it himself. I trust him 100%. He's a brother to me. I trust him to, make the right decisions and not have to worry about him. And I was hoping the same. He didn't have to worry about me. So, I let him do his thing, and I just, he made some great decisions that made the situation better.
Now we're starting to take fire. I still don't know how any of us got hit. It was utterly amazing when we started taking contact from three different, because it's like you try to do some first aid, get some stuff together, we're taking fire, you gotta take cover. I don't even know who said that we need the gator down here. So I ran up the hill to get it, and Pereira beat me to it. And so he's already in there, and the gear is, you have to like jam it in, you put your foot on the brake, you jam it into gear, but if you don't know, it grinds, so it's that, reflex to back off. Well, he's grinding, I'm like, let me drive. No, I got it. No, let me drive. He drives it down, and then backs it right up to us, so it was a quick load up, and Pereira was able to drive him out, but I just remember we had to take cover again. And then I hear Pereira yell out. And I didn't realize it at the time, but he said, hey, no man left behind. We're not leaving without Mary. I was never so stoked. I was so pumped. I wasn't even afraid. I was so, it was like, we knew we were making a stand. We weren't going anywhere. We had our determination. And it was just by one statement.
He couldn't do anything better that day to help the situation, and I'm glad he did. It made everything better. It saved guys' lives, and the quick thinking outside the box is is what we need, and he definitely stood up that day, and that's what counts. I'm glad to serve with him.
This day was the most profound thing I'd ever seen. When I finally told my wife, and this was months afterwards, I finally sat down when I was home on Don's, and I told her, you know why I took this job? It was not for the money I could make. It was to serve my country. It was to help the soldiers. That was my job. It wasn't about me. It was what I could do to help the soldier. And that day, when you see everybody stand together, fight together, and be a team, and nothing's staring you down, nothing's gonna run you off, not fire from three different directions. I was so proud that day. I was so proud that day to be an American. I was so proud to be with Hard Rock. It was the most defining moment. After 30 years of law enforcement, 30 years, 2 years with the Army, I'm the most proud of.
I want to thank everyone for being here today. Many of you came from many miles away to pay tribute to a distinguished American who so selflessly risked his life to save others. And today, as you all know, we recognize Sergeant Felipe Pereira for his extraordinary actions in the face of adversity and a determined enemy. He is a patriot through and through to both the United States and his native country, Brazil. I know that it's not easy to have to relive November 1st, 2010, but we are all here because your actions distinguish you as a hero. And the reality is there are people alive today because of those actions. And some of them are here today with us outside. So Sergeant Pereira, what a distinct honor it is to be able to recognize this outstanding professional and honorable warfighter, to give due recognition for this undaunted bravery and demonstrated courage under fire. It's events like this award ceremony that make this job as the Army Chief of Staff so rewarding. Being humbled by soldiers like Sergeant Pereira, who is now adding to the legend of the 101st Airborne Division and the legend of our United States Army. What happened in Sanjere Zari District, Afghanistan on November 1st, 2010 was the ultimate test of skills, leadership, and inner fortitude. In that defining moment, Sergeant Pereira's actions will be forever etched in our nation's history to be remembered and studied by service members, scholars, and historians in all the years to come. He said that his squad all fought together. It was one effort. And this medal is for all of us. Sergeant Pereira, the Distinguished Service Cross that you will soon wear is yours. Wear it with remembrance and knowing that the blood of your two friends was not shed in vain. Wear it with pride, knowing that you have earned it with the approval of your peers, your chain of command, the Army leadership, and the Commander-in-Chief. Wear it with distinction, knowing there are only 164 other Screaming Eagle soldiers in the 70-year history of the 101st Airborne Division that have been awarded this prestigious badge of courage. Wear it with honor, knowing you represent something greater than yourself when you don that uniform. And you were awarded this honor because you went above and beyond the call of duty. And wear it proudly, knowing that your medal represents the thanks of a grateful nation.
The Distinguished Service Cross, it's a great honor. And the ceremony was incredible, beyond what I've imagined. Having my unit, my family, my friends, the families from the lost brothers, it meant everything to me. But I need you to understand that this award, this honor, belongs to every soldier, to every person that shared that day with me. I cannot imagine sharing that day with greater soldiers. Those are my heroes. And I am proud to be surrounded by heroes. Here at Strike, here at the 101st, here at the U.S. Army. Heroes. This cross on my chest is as much theirs as it is mine. I love them. And it's been my honor to have fought by their side. No man left behind, right? No man left behind.